Well, good morning and welcome to worship at Marco Presbyterian Church on Sunday morning. You found us and we're glad you're here. Don't forget to continue to engage with us through all of our different opportunities. And I want to encourage you that if you haven't yet downloaded our app, we do now have an app where you can remain connected. You can download sermons. You can keep updated with our events. Now, we are going to be getting back into the building, so keep updated even on that news as it comes out. Be looking for that this week. Now, even though we haven't been on site, but we've been online, we continue to be on mission. And here is one of our ministries that this church generously supports right up the road at Florida Gulf Coast University. We support a ministry called Reformed University Fellowship, RUF. What that ministry does is it preaches Christ to college students, primarily through large group and then small group Bible studies. We support a ministry there led by Lucas Tanner, and he's gotten some of his students together to help us understand, what does RUF do? Here it is.
My name is Brett McFarland. I'm from Orlando, Florida, and it is my second year here at FGCU. RUF has really shaped me, both as a person and I think also in my walk with God. When I came to FGCU, I felt pretty lost in a lot of aspects of my life. I wasn't really close to too many people, and I really wasn't close to God at all. And RUF gave me the opportunity to grow closer to people that I knew at FGCU, and it also gave me the opportunity to grow closer with Christ. And in the past year, I feel like I've grown as a Christian more than I have in my entire life. I'm thankful for RUF because of the community it's given me, the people I'm surrounded with. It's kind of given me relationships that I know are gonna last for a long time and that are really valuable to me. If it wasn't for RUF, I really don't think I'd be as strong as a Christian as I am today, or a Christian in general, or involved in church or anything related to the faith at all. If it wasn't for RUF, I'd be pretty lost.
Our call to worship today is found in Psalm 117. If you would like to turn in your Bible with me to Psalm 117 as we read it all together, and then I will begin us in prayer. Again, this is Psalm 117, verses 1 and 2. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Let us pray as we come into worship, into God's courts of praise. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come into your presence with singing and your courts with praise, and that ultimately the gospel of Jesus Christ and his resurrection goes out to all peoples and to all nations. I pray that all of us today might be able to exemplify that and be reminded of who we are in you and in your Son, and be able to go out and share that with other people. I pray for this service that it might be glorifying to you. And we pray this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
Saw thee when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me
Well, one of our elements of worship each week in the church body is that we also give generously. We give because God has given us much. I want to read, follow Jonathan and read Psalm 118. So if you still have your Bibles open, just look at the next verse. It says this, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." And then verse 2 says, "Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever." Remember, attached to the love of the Lord for us is a response where we say, his steadfast love endures forever. He's loving me, and therefore I can love others well. We want to repeat that. We want to say that. So we do that by giving. We give generously of the things that God has given us. We say this. We don't give necessarily just to the church, but we give through the church. You've seen how some of our missions dollars work in Reformed University Fellowship. And so now we just take a moment. I'll pray for our giving, but I also want to pray for our pastor, Steve, as he recovers from some work being done on his physical heart. So will you pray with me? Our Father, we're grateful that you have given us much, and we pray that you would help us to be generous in the way that we give, not just of our tithes and our offerings, but with our lives. We do pray that you would help us to be generous with all of the things that you've given us. We pray, Father, that you would be made much of in our lives. We also, Father, pray for Pastor Steve. Would you continue to heal his body, help him to recover and regain his strength, and particularly, Father, for his heart. We pray that you would heal it quickly. We do pray for all of our people, especially undergoing different procedures during this very difficult moment. We pray that you would heal them quickly. We love you, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our sermon today is found in Acts 10, verses 34 through 43. I would actually encourage all of you to open your Bibles and go to Acts 10, verses 34 through 43 as we begin and hear God's word for the sermon today. So, let me read for us our passage found in Acts 10, verses 34 through 43. "So Peter opened his mouth and said, 'Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourself know what has happened in all of Judea, beginning from Galilee all the way to the baptism that John proclaimed. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he, Jesus, commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." Would you pray with me? Please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you show no favoritism, that you show no partiality towards any people, and that even when we ourselves find ourselves falling into prejudice, when we are worried about what distinctions we can make, that that is completely contrary to what the gospel teaches us. I pray that you might speak through me and that the power might come through your words that is powerful enough to rebuke us, but it's powerful enough to give us hope. And I pray that we might be able to see Jesus clearly and what he has done through the cross and how that is able to transform our minds. We pray this in his holy name. Amen. You most likely have heard of or read a work by Theodore Geisler, or how he is better known by, and how you may know him, Dr. Seuss. After working on a PhD from the prestigious Cambridge University, Geisler went on to make children's books that we still love today, such as The Cat in the Hat, or How the Grinch Stole Christmas, and of course, who can forget my personal favorite and the greatest example of a Cambridge education, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish. But one work that is often forgotten about by Dr. Seuss, and we don't talk about as much, is The Sneetches. And in this book, we see something that remains telling for how we view society today. Because in The Sneetches, there are two different groups of people. The Sneetches with bellies with stars, while the plain-bellied Sneetches have none upon theirs. And because of this simple division, that there is partiality, there is favoritism, there is prejudice between any Sneetch that does not fit within the other's social position. And this problem, this tension that Dr. Seuss creates, develops to such a degree that we cannot tell by the end of the story who or what the difference is between a star-bellied Sneetch and a plain-bellied Sneetch. My goal is not to trivialize the seriousness of what Dr. Seuss has brought up just because it is a children's book, but rather to show us that there is a serious issue that presents to us today that even children's books are talking about it. You may think and watch Fox News or CNN or MSNBC, and all of them say the same thing. The tragic death of George Floyd, the riots that are going on throughout America currently, and the systemic issue that faces many Americans today causes us to be uncomfortable with a sin issue that many of us face. But even me talking about this now, and you scrolling through Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, you might be so fed up with this problem that you don't actually even want to listen right now, and that you're looking for the next church that you can scroll to and listen to their sermon. But what's often forgotten is, what does the Bible say about prejudice? In fact, let's be even starker. What does the gospel tell us about racism? Because in our passage today, Peter and God himself give us one simple truth, one biblical truth that we can take away from today. And that is, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are to show no partiality to how we treat all people. Again, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are to show no partiality in how we treat all people. Because look at what Peter says in our passage again. Look at verses 34, where Peter tells us, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." That actually, us looking at it, we see that God has no ethnic dimension in which he determines salvation. Going even further in verse 36, we see this message that began in Israel with Peter, but then it goes out to such an extent that the Gentiles are able to talk about it. Look at verse 36 or verse 37, where Peter tells Cornelius, "You yourself know what has happened throughout all Judea." But going even further than that, there's one thing that they have missed about, and this is why Peter has come to Cornelius today, to go down and look at verse 39, where Peter tells us that he himself was a witness to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that even going starker, because of that death and resurrection, because of what Christ has accomplished, Peter is commanded to go out into the entire world and to preach this gospel without distinction and without prejudice. So with this bird's eye view of our passage today, you might assume and presume that Peter has always believed this, that he's never faced this problem himself. But actually, I'd encourage you to read all of chapter 10 in your free time and see this full picture. But actually, in our story today, we see a very different thing going on. Because look and see two different people that are in our passage. We see Cornelius, who in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 10 is a man that loves God. He abundantly gives financially to people in need, and he prays daily that he would be a perfect example of what any church would want. And then there's one problem that Cornelius is having, though. That actually, Cornelius is an Italian centurion, and by extension, that means that he is a Gentile, and that he doesn't have access to the message that is being proclaimed at this moment. But then look again at our passage. Look at verses 9 through 16, where we see our other man, Peter, the eminent disciple of Jesus, the Messiah himself, who has just died and now he is going out. But Peter now, in Acts 10, has had a vision from God, and God tells him that the Old Testament dietary laws have been lifted, and that Peter is no longer to call anything unclean what God has declared clean. And it's because of these two men that we see, whose paths converge, a Jewish fisherman and an Italian centurion, and they have come together for God's own purpose. But it's actually because of this convergence that we see the problem of our passage today. Because look at verse 28 of chapter 10, of what Peter tells Cornelius when he comes into his house. That you yourself, Cornelius, know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. That there was this assumption by the Jewish people, there was actually this custom they had that they couldn't even come into a Gentile's home. And you could almost imagine Peter grimacing walking into the house. It would have been tense with our passage. It would have been so awkward. But the bigger issue is that what Peter just said there is actually unbiblical. Because the custom they're talking about was what Jewish rabbis interpreted that the Old Testament was saying. And I would encourage you in your free time to read all of the Old Testament. Read Genesis to Malachi and find one commandment where God says to do this. And the problem is, God never told them to do this, because actually, the distinction between Jew and Gentile in the Old Testament was for religious purity. That God has set apart the nation of Israel to be a holy people to himself, and that they were to not intermix with other nations because other nations were worshiping other gods. But actually, throughout the Old Testament, we see Gentiles that are commanded to come and see what God is doing in Israel. Look at Rahab and Ruth, that even King David himself, his lineage, the greatest king of Israel, came from a Moabite family. And it's with that that we see the problem of our passage today, that there's actually something deep that even comes to us today. And that is that we can find ourselves having unbiblical assumptions inform how we treat other people. Even Peter, if we were to go beyond our passage and look at Galatians 2, a letter that Paul writes to the church, and Paul tells Peter, or he tells the church that he opposed Peter to his face because of his preferential treatment of the Jewish believers and ignoring Gentile believers. But how often do we find ourselves wanting to show prejudice with who we offer the gospel to? In fact, let's be very blunt here, that you might be suffering and you might actually be facing racist attitudes right now. And that can be explicit and that can also be implicit. It might be the jokes that you make in private. It might be the dismissive attitude that we so often fall into of other people's suffering. And then we can even do that where it's such a problem for us that we show prejudice to who we share the gospel with. That people are just gospel opportunities for us rather than people that we are supposed to have deep, lasting friendships with. This doesn't have to just be about race. That you can find yourself doing this with people in different socioeconomic positions than yourself. People that, God forbid, come from a different political background than you. Because all of us suffer this implicit bias
And we want to ignore it. We want to hide from it. But the reality is that Scripture tells us here that these biases are sin. What are we supposed to do, though? What does Scripture tell us about our prejudice or even our racist thoughts that Peter himself fell into? Look at the passage again, because that's where we find our answer. In verses 42 and 43, where Peter says that Jesus commanded us to preach to people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. That if you are asking, why is it that I should share the gospel without prejudice or distinction? It's because Jesus himself has commanded us to go out and do this. And if you're asking, why should I listen to Jesus? It's because Scripture tells us here that all of the Bible, from the Old Testament to New, is moving towards this resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has died on the cross for all people's sins. That because Jesus has commanded us, we can apply this today. And if you are listening and wanting to know the major application to walk away with, it's here. It's right now, where Scripture tells us because of Christ's resurrection, he commands us to share the gospel without prejudice and to transform how we treat other people. That because of Christ's resurrection, we are commanded to share the gospel without prejudice and to transform how we think of others. But where am I getting that idea of transformation from? Look back at verse 34, how Peter starts his message saying, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality. And that the idea there, what Peter is essentially saying is, I've come to terms. I understand what God has been telling me all along. That actually, I like how the NIV translates this verse when it says, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism. So when you're seeking to apply this to your life today, there are several ways that we can be looking at this. That first, we are to repent of and turn from any biases and prejudice that we hold on to. That might not be explicitly, but just the way we view the world, we are to turn from this sinful attitude. But second, we are to actually go out and realize Scripture never gives us distinction for who we share the gospel with. We are to give the gospel to everyone. And that going even further than that, that means that you don't just give these gospel opportunities and then never talk to the person again. That you're actually supposed to build lasting and robustly biblical friendships with people that think differently than what you do. But lastly, and most importantly, this passage gives us hope. Because look at it again. You might be worried of all these thoughts that you think, that you hold on to for so long, that all of us deal with. Because the reality is we all have a fallen and sinful mind. But because of what Christ has accomplished at the cross, because of this resurrection, that we actually can have our minds transformed. Look at Peter, the premier disciple of Jesus who hung out with him for 3 years, and he didn't get it until now. And yet he finally has turned from this attitude and says, I am no longer going to hold on to these prejudices. I'm going to share the gospel without distinction with all people. That is essentially what Scripture is telling us today. That there is no sin that is beyond redemption of the cross. That we can turn to God and say that I believe in Jesus, and I put my faith and trust in him. I repent from my sins and turn to him as my Savior and Lord. And Scripture is telling us that we will be forgiven. We will not be condemned, but we will be brought into God's family. Because essentially the whole purpose of this passage and what we can take away from is that because of what Christ has done, the gospel goes out to all people. And thank God that includes sinners like ourselves. Would you pray with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that we are to go out and share this gospel with people. That so often we can hold prejudices and we can so often distinguish who we want to share this with. I pray that we realize that because of what Christ has accomplished at the cross, We are to mortify these sins and to go out and transform our minds, to build relationships with people that are differently than us. Pray that we would be reminded of Christ's resurrection and what he has accomplished, and we pray this in his holy name.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender to you, my Savior. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered.
Well, thank God that our hope is in Christ himself. And this day, as we have worshiped together, Jonathan has done such a great job of reminding us where our hope is, that because of the resurrection of Christ, there's no partiality shown to anyone. And so we not only get the benefit of hearing the gospel because people have believed that themselves, but now we, as folks who've heard the gospel and now believe in Jesus, we can go out and show no partiality in the way that we preach Christ. And so even today, I'm thinking and remembering Romans chapter 3, verse 10, that says, there's no one who is righteous, no, not one. And so we as believers, we repent. We humble ourselves before a gracious God. And then we begin more and more to see opportunities where we might preach Christ to all kinds of people. And that's a joy for us to be able to be involved in even today. Even today, you're going to have an opportunity to do that. So continue to walk with the Father in doing that. I want to read for us the benediction after I pray for our service today. Father, we're grateful that indeed you do show us through your scripture the reality of the world. Again, you show us a clarified worldview, which is that you love all men and women independent of their race, their color, their language, their intelligence, their socioeconomics, their politics, where they live, any of that, Father. You love us all. And we all have the equal opportunity to believe in Jesus. And so we do pray that, Father, today you would help us to believe more and more, to grow in our faith, but also, Father, would you give us opportunities to preach Christ wherever we go. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so now receive the Lord's benediction from Numbers chapter 6, which says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace."